Dear Ambassador of Israel, dear bishops, dear leaders of the Jewish community, I gave a lot of lectures, I have to admit. And many times, with the presence of the enemies of Israel, many times with the supporters of the BDS. And I have to admit that here I feel empowered because of you. You give me strength. You give us all hope that truth must win. Many of us, most of us, and in this place, probably all of us, are supporters of Israel. But all of us are exposed to the terrible propaganda against Israel. You hear it from the media, you hear it from the academia. And many times, even if we are pro-Israelis, we are challenged. We don't know the answers. Sometimes we feel that we are manipulated, but we don't know the correct answers. In my very limited time, I will try to equip you with some information about the so many lies of this camp of hatred, of the camp of the campaign of lies. It will be my modest contribution to the struggle for truth, to the struggle for peace, to the struggle for reconciliation. That's what we need. We don't need lies. Let me begin. First thing, my whole campaign, my whole struggle against lies is because we fight for peace. We fight for reconciliations. Others fight for hatred, not we. And some history, we all speak about Palestine. Palestine, as a political entity, did not exist. Never, actually. If you will go to the map of the Ottoman Empire, you will not find any Palestine. It did not exist. Palestine was the name that was used mainly by Christians, not by Muslims, and let me tell you, even not by Jews. It came much later. Here is a map of this area in the Ottoman times. You will find a lot of districts, but you will not find Palestine because it did not exist. At the end of the 19th century, it was Britain who sent a delegation. It was called Palestine Exploration Fund in order to research this area, to know what's going on in this piece of land that they called Palestine. Here is what they found. This is Haifa. I don't know how many of you know Haifa, but only the red part that you see was settled. That's all. This is exactly the time when Zionism began. And this is, for example, Jerusalem. To those of you who don't know, Jerusalem of today is much bigger than all the map that you see. And the same about Tel Aviv. That was only Jaffa. That was a very small place. 200 meters. People don't know it. And it's going on and on. We spoke already about the Balfour Declaration, and we have to understand. People don't understand why, how come that the Jewish people was recognized to have the right for self-determination. It happened because in that time in history, when empires collapsed, a new right emerged, which is the right for self-determination. Jews were part of it. The whole idea of Zionism is against colonialism and against imperialism, just like other national movements. And it went on. In that time, the leader of the Muslim world, he wrote, "We are welcoming the Jews who are coming to this piece of land, totally forgotten by people who distort history." An agreement was achieved in 1919 between the leader of the Muslims and the leader of the Zionist movement. They agreed upon to establish a Jewish state. So to tell you now that the Muslims were always against a Jewish state, it's a lie. The agreement is known. Here it is in front of you. And it went on and on. This is the piece of land that was allocated for the Jewish state under the British mandate. And eventually, many other Arab states were established. When you look at the map and you want to compare between Israel and the surrounding countries of the Arab world, you can barely see Israel. A very small, tiny piece of land. You cannot see it when you compare it to the Muslim world. You just cannot. This is not the problem of the Middle East. This is not the problem of the Arab world. And it went on and on. It was ratified in many international institutions in that time. It was decided upon to accept the Balfour Declaration by the League of Nations. And it went on and on and on and on. Eventually, what happened is that there was the first partition in 1922. The big Palestine became two entities. One is Transjordan, and the other was left to the Jewish state. And it went on and on and on. Partition again was proposed by the Peel Commission. Peel Commission in order to solve the problem between Jews and Arabs in Palestine. It was rejected by the Arab leadership. And it went on and on and on. But history, unfortunately, again and again, is manipulated. Now what we are facing is a new stage. A new stage of nowadays is a stage that is full of lies. I'll give you just some example in order to understand this kind of campaign of lies. Here is someone, a scholar, who wrote an article in a very prestigious magazine in Britain. And he wrote as follows: "Gas chambers are not the only way to destroy a nation. It's enough to develop high rates of infant mortality. Which means that the Jews, Israel of today, is conducting a kind of extermination against Palestinians. Israelis now are just like the Nazis 80 and 70 years ago. That's what he's saying. How they do it in a very tricky way, by increasing infant mortality among Palestinians. I saw it, I read it, and I was amazed. So I checked. I went to the World Bank data and to the World Health Organization data, and what I found out that actually infant mortality among Palestinians decreased dramatically, just the opposite. So what he published was a blood libel. When you read newspapers today about what Israel is doing, just bear in mind that many things that you read are lies. And it's going on and on and on. Simple lies. Gaza village flooded as Israel opens dam gates. There is only one problem with this story that published in so many newspapers in the world. There is not any dam in Israel. And it's going on and on and on. Here is a professor from an elite university in the United States. He's saying that I'm going to tell you truth, facts on the ground. And he published that Tel Aviv is the only Western city that does not have any Arab or Muslim inhabitants. It's not even a joke. My doctor is an Arab. And he lives in Tel Aviv, and I'm proud of it. This is the reality of Israel. This is the reality of Israel, not of apartheid, as they are telling you. People don't know it. People are manipulated. And he wrote that Netanyahu, the prime minister of Israel, called to expel the 1.6 million Palestinians who are Israeli citizens. Again, a lie. What he said in that very conference that this professor spoke about was the Jewish state of Israel will always protect the rights of all the more than 1 million Arab citizens. Just the opposite. But they lie. And it's going on and on and on and on. We don't have time to see everything. We don't have time. I'm sorry. I asked for 7 hours. I did not receive. Professor Juan Cole from the United States, president of MESA. MESA is Middle East Studies Association in the United States. He published an article saying that according to the 9/11 commission report, the official commission immediately was nominated immediately after the 9/11, Al-Qaeda conceived the attack as response to the Israeli attack on Jenin. You know what? One sentence with three lies. First, it was never written in the commission report. You will never find the word Jenin. You will immediately understand why. There was not any attack. Second lie, there was not any attack on Jenin. There was a battle. Many Israeli soldiers were killed. And the last lie, an unbelievable lie. The story about Jenin was 7 months after the 9/11. And it's going on and on and on and on. Ayat Tamimi, maybe you heard about her. She became a star in many places in the world lately. And here she is actually, since when she is 8 years old, she's playing the same role. She is staged by many journalists in order to have this kind of confrontations with Israeli soldiers. It's all a show, and she's even rewarded with prizes for her great role. Here she is with the president of Turkey and with others, rewarded. But people think, wow, Israel is oppressing this kind of people, children. A lie again. And it's going on and on and on. Last month, we had so many confrontations between Gaza and Israel on the fence. So many people claimed again and again that, oh, peaceful demonstrations, and how comes that you kill them? No, we don't want to kill anybody. We don't want, but here are the people that demonstrate. That's what they don't show you on TV. Because it will destroy the whole narrative of peaceful demonstrations. They don't show you what they do. They don't show you that actually they support the Nazis, which is so sad for them and for us. That's what they are doing now. And it's going on and on and on and on. The biggest story, I think, of the BDS, not the only one, but the biggest story of the BDS is the Nakba. And according to them, Israel has no right to exist. Why? Because Israel in 1948 forced hundreds of thousands of people out of the land. So let's get back a little in order to understand what happened in 1948. Because this is one of the biggest manipulations of the BDS. What really happened is that 100 years ago, in the first half of the previous century, we had empires. Empires, by their nature, were multi-ethnic, multi-religious. When the new phenomena began of self-determination, nation-states were created. And when nation-states were created, there was a huge wave of population exchange between Turkey and Greece, for example. Almost 2 million people were forced out of their homelands. Turks from Greece were forced out to Turkey. Greeks from Turkey were forced out to Greece. And it went on and on and on and on. Only in the Balkans, we are speaking about 7 million people. And it's going on and on with more than 12 million Germans that were forced out of their homelands in all the neighboring countries of Germany. And it went on and on between Poland and Ukraine. It went on and on between India and Pakistan. It went on and on in Cyprus. It went on and on also in Armenia and Azerbaijan. You know what? In that time, 100 years ago, and in the first half of the previous century, it was the norm. It was the standard. It was the most acceptable way to solve problems. I'm not saying that it's good. It's not what I'm saying. What I'm saying is that you cannot single out one state and say that this state committed a crime when it was the norm in every conflict. This person, for example, Fridtjof Nansen, he received the Nobel Prize for initiating and conducting the population exchange between Turkey and Greece. And it went on and on. The highest international court of the time, Permanent Court of International Justice, decided upon that this is the best way to solve problems in order to achieve peace. And even Arab Muslim leaders supported this kind of solution in that time. Totally forgotten, the Peel Commission that I already mentioned, recommended upon population exchange. And it went on and on and on with more Arab leaders. And on, the Labour Party in Britain recommended population exchange between Jews and Arabs. Winston Churchill, the leader of the free world in that time, in 1944, before the end of the Second World War, declared in London, in the British Parliament, expulsion is the method which will the most satisfactory and lasting, and so on and so on. There will be no mixture of population to cause endless trouble. We have to understand the atmosphere and the norms of the time. Only in Europe, only after the Second World War, we are speaking about more than 20 million people that were forced out. And we cannot forget the Mufti. He was the leader of the Arabs under Palestine. He collaborated with Hitler, and he wrote in his memoirs, "Our fundamental condition for cooperating with Germany was a free hand to eradicate every last Jew from Palestine and the Arab world." And in the year before the independence war in 48, so many Arab leaders, actually all the Arab leaders, declared that they are coming actually to exterminate the Jewish entity. And the most important leader of the time of the Arab world, Nuri al-Said, said, "Arabs should conduct their wives and children to safe areas until the fighting has died down. We will smash the country with our guns and obliterate every shelter of Jews." It was the reality of the time. People do not understand what Israel faced in the first days after the declaration of independence. Threats of extermination 3 years after the Holocaust. And it's going on and on and on. So many other Arab leaders who declared the same kind of propaganda. "We are going to exterminate the not even born Jewish state." And something which is totally forgotten, the Jews from Arab countries. Let me tell you, my grandmother came to Israel as a refugee because she was under threat. Many Jews were forced out from Arab countries because they were under threat. A lot of massacres against Jews were conducted in the Muslim and Arab world. And it was decided upon by the Arab League that the Jews from Arab countries are going to pay the price. They did not declare any war on anybody, but they were supposed to pay the price. And yes, a lot of massacres took place in that time against Jews in every Arab country. The outcome was that they were forced actually to escape. They were forced out from every Arab country. Altogether, we are speaking about 711,000 of Arabs. I call them Arabs and not Palestinians. You know why? Because in that time, they were not Palestinians. In that time, they called themselves Arabs. My parents, who grew up in Palestine, were called Palestinians, not the Arabs. Not the Arabs. People don't know it. They think Palestine, ooh, Palestinians, ooh, very old people. Not at all. Not at all. And we have to remember that a bigger number of Jews were forced out from Arab countries. All their property was confiscated, totally forgotten. The Jewish Nakba. Everyone is speaking about the Palestinian Nakba. Nobody is speaking about the Jewish Nakba. Totally forgotten. How come? How come that so many media and academia people distort history? They do. And it's going on and on. When they came to Israel, the Jews from Arab countries, they lived in refugee camps for years. Altogether, we are speaking about 52 million people from that time that became refugees. How many of them are refugees today? Zero. No one is a refugee from that time, except one community. Only one community, the Palestinians. They emerged to more than 5 million people. And it's going on and on and on. I don't have time to go to all of it. The UN. The UN established in that time two agencies to take care of the refugees. One is UNHCR to all the refugees in the world, and one is UNRWA that was specified, dedicated only to the Arabs from Palestine. Why do we need two agencies? But it was not only UNRWA. There was only one that nobody knows about, that is called UNCRA. What is UNCRA? The same like UNRWA, but for the refugees of Korea. Because of the war in Korea. And this agency worked only from 51 until 59, and the problem was solved. No more refugees, no more anything. And nobody even knows about UNCRA. But UNRWA, you know how much time was wasted until today? First, let me tell you about UNCRA. UNCRA, with $148 million, solved the problem of 3 million refugees. It's over. We don't know about any refugee. UNRWA, from the very day of its foundation up to today, we are speaking about almost $50 billion. They could build a villa and a business to every refugee. But they never did. They never did. They perpetuated the problem. They made things worse instead of to solve the problem. And it's going on and on and on. The definition of a refugee is not the same definition. And in every aspect, there is a huge difference between UNRWA and the UNHCR. UNHCR solved the problem of 50 million people. UNRWA increased the problem from 700,000 to more than 5 million people. And it's going on and on and on and on. And you know what? Many Arab leaders even admit that they created the problem deliberately, intentionally. And it's going on and on. Even Abu Mazen admitted years ago that it was a Muslim world, the Arab armies, who created the problem and not Israel. And it's going on and on and on. Eventually, what happened is they rejected the partition plan of the UN, the Arabs, all the Arabs leaders. And they rejected it once and again. And Rabbi Tapiero already elaborated about it. I will not repeat it. The outcome was that Israel was created after the war. And here we are coming to the 67 war, the Six Days War. Now, just bear in mind one thing. Between 49, the end of the Independence War, and 67, the Six Days War, when Israel was forced to occupy Judea, Samaria, and Gaza, there was not any Israeli occupation. How come that a Palestinian state was not established? Israel was not there. It was under an Arab rule. How come that there was not a Palestinian state? Why you do not ask those BDS activists, how come that you complain against Israel? But you had it all under your control. Why did not you establish a state? They never wanted a Palestinian state. They never wanted. They were offered again and again. And Rabbi Tapiero repeated all their rejectionism again and again. So before the war, that Israel did not want, by the way, the Six Days Wars, 1967, Israel did not want, but the Arab League declared, we are coming to destroy the state of Israel. There was not occupation, nothing. The same, every Arab leader in that time declared, once and again, we are coming to destroy this country. There was not occupation, to say it again. And it's going on and on. Ahmed Shukeri, who was the leader of the Palestinians, he declared 3 days before the war began. 3 days. Because they were sure that they are going to wipe Israel out of the map. They were completely sure. And I was a child, and we were afraid. Yes, it's going to happen. A new Holocaust is coming. We were afraid. I do remember myself digging in my garden a shelter because we did not have any basements in that time. And he declared, and I do remember as a child his declaration, whoever survives, which means among the Jews, will stay in Palestine. Oh, thank you. But in my opinion, he said, no one will remain alive. Totally forgotten. Now, people blame Israel. How come? How come that you occupied the territories? They don't understand the background. They don't know history. But they complain about Israel. And now they speak about life under occupation. Now, the whole story of the Israeli control is under debate, a legitimate debate, by the way. Not everything is part of the demonization and hatred campaign. Not everything. But even here, they cannot without lies. Here is a Nobel Prize winner, José Saramago, saying that what is happening in Palestine is a crime as what happened at Auschwitz. Wow. Again, this kind of idea that the Israelis behave like the Nazis. When we check the facts, we find out that actually we spoke already about infant mortality among Palestinians is much better than the global average. And it's much better than even Turkey. The same is with life expectancy. Palestinians are doing much better than the global average, and they do much better, by the way, than South Africa, and they do much better than even some European countries. And you know why? because of the Israeli health system that did not oppress them, but helped them. Totally unknown. And it's going on and on and on. You know, many times people here in the universities, they say we have to boycott of Israel because Israel destroyed the Palestinian education. Wow, really? Israel destroyed the Palestinian education? Let's see the facts. Only according to Palestinian resources. Gabi Barmaki, who was the president of Birzeit University, he admitted in 1967, we did not have even one university. Right now, according to the Palestinian Authority, we have more than 40 high education institutions. And right now, according to them, Palestinians have the highest per capita rate of university graduates in the Arab world. You can be against occupation, you can criticize Israel, you don't have to lie. You don't have to lie, and people lie all the time. Because my time is short, I will skip in order to get just to something that we should know. Again and again, Israel is portrayed as a Nazi state. Again and again. Some people say the oppression of the Palestinian people is the major cause of violence in the world. She even blamed, she was a minister in the British cabinet, she even blamed Israel in the global warming. I have no idea what is the connection between Israel and the global warming. When people are obsessed, it's all the way. And it's going on and on and on. You see in global polls that people believe. They believe it. Because this kind of brainwashing machine that is lying endlessly. And it's going on and on and on. I mean, and let's see what is the contribution of Israel to violence. Altogether, since the foundation of Israel up to now, we are speaking about 86 million people who were killed in so many conflicts. 12 million people were killed in the Muslim and Arab world, most of them by Muslims and Arabs. In the Israeli-Arab conflict, altogether, we are speaking about between 80 to 120 Arabs who were killed, which I'm sorry about each one of them. I'm not glad, I'm just giving you the proportions in order to understand. Under the Israeli control, we are speaking about between 11 to 12,000 people. Again, which I'm not proud about, but we have to understand the proportions. The contribution of Israel to violence in the world is about 0.0006 something. Statistically, zero. But yet so many people blame Israel again and again. We don't have time, so I'm going to... The main problem, we must mention it, the main problem of the Muslim and Arab world right now is the global jihad. But remember just one thing. Contrary to what people think, the global jihad is not against Americans or Europeans or Israelis. The global jihad is killing mainly Muslims. 99% of the victims of the global jihad are Muslims. They kill themselves. Nothing to do with the Israeli-Arab conflict. Nothing, zero. But yet, you hear again and again, oh, it's because of the Israeli-Arab conflict. And it's going on and on and on and on and on. Something which is highly important. The leader of ISIS, Abu Bakr al-Baghdadi, he declared, "We are coming to conquer Rome." I gave a lecture in Rome in that time, in the Foreign Ministry Academy. And they told me, look, Mr. Yemini, there is a difference between ISIS and the Hamas, a huge difference. They, ISIS, are looking for, you know, the huge Islamic empire, caliphate, as they call it. But the Hamas is fighting only against Israel, is not part of the global jihad. Then I immediately showed them, I immediately showed them two video clips of two leaders of the Hamas and what they are talking about. And what they are talking about conquering Rome. We don't have time to see it.
This, in their own voices, is Hamas.
Huh? وإذا كانت اليوم هي عاصمة الكاثوليك أو الصليبية التي أعلنت عداءها للإسلام ليمنعوا نهضة الإسلام من جديد ستكون عاصمتهم نقطة متقدمة للفتوحات الإسلامية.
This is Hamas, this is not ISIS. They are the same. People don't understand it. And just one thing. Listen to what the Hamas is broadcasting in their own official TV channel. Look at the translation. It's just unbelievable. Listen.
ثم يا ربنا ويا مولانا ويا سيدنا اهزم أعداءك وأعداء الدين في كل مكان اللهم عليك باليهود ومن هاودهم والنصارى ومن ناصرهم والشيوعيين ومن شايعهم اللهم أحصهم عددا واقتلهم بددا ولا تغادر منهم أحدا.
I hope you begin to understand what the Hamas is. Not only Jews. Let's kill all the Christians. People don't know it. And I ask many journalists in many places in the world, why don't you broadcast it? Why don't you show your peoples, your audience, what the Hamas is? They don't show. And it's going on and on and on. I will skip the chapter about peace because we don't have time, and I guess Rabbi Tapiero already spoke about it, so I will skip it and skip it and skip it in order just to get to some words about the apartheid lie. Apartheid, you hear it again and again. Israel is an apartheid state. It's very interesting because the leader of the BDS, who is running this kind of apartheid weeks all around the world, he is a student in Tel Aviv University. He is calling everybody else to boycott Israel, but he is a student, PhD student in Tel Aviv University. And it's going on and on and on. Here is Miss Israel, Rana Raslan, an Arab citizen of Israel. Wow, an apartheid state. Very interesting. And it's going on and on and on. I don't have time to show you everything. Just something which is very interesting. Moshe Katsav, who was the president of Israel, president of the Jewish state, he was sentenced to 7 years in jail, which I'm not proud about. I'm not. He had three judges. The presiding judge, George Kara, an Israeli Arab. Can you imagine in the apartheid time a black judge sending the president of South Africa to 7 years in jail? But yet they are saying that Israel is an apartheid state. What are they talking about? And just last thing, you know, again and again we hear, whoa, maybe Israel has the right to defend itself, but Israel is killing Arabs in a very disproportionate way. And the most terrible document that was published was by Richard Goldstone. I guess he is known to some of you because he was judge here in South Africa. And he wrote 600 pages that you did not read, but I had to read. And to summarize all what he said was, Israel intentionally killed innocent civilians. Wow. Wow. I know my friends. I know the Israeli soldiers. They are doing everything in order to protect innocent civilians. Everything. More than any other army, and I'm going to prove it in the last 2 minutes that I have, because they are looking at me in order to finish.
You know, the U.S. and its war on terror, carpet bombs Afghanistan.
When he published his report, he was interviewed again and again. And every media channel asked him the same question. Why do you blame Israel when innocent civilians are killed and in every battlefield? Let's hear what he said.
You know, the U.S. and its war on terror, carpet bombs Afghanistan and Iraq and hurts innocent civilians. Is the U.S. then guilty of war crimes?
Well, certainly if war crimes were committed, of course they should be investigated. Any war crime should be investigated. And, you know, I don't with respect accept your description of what they did. It's something obviously I haven't investigated.
You know what? Fair enough. He did not investigate. Fair enough. Fair enough. Until you will hear, 2 days later, he was asked by an American journalist the same kind of question. Let's hear, and he has a new answer, a surprising one.
Israelis claim that if you hold them to this standard that you've just described, that law prescribes for conflict, any democracy that's fighting terrorism is likely to find itself dragged into an international court of justice. I mean, do you consider that a valid concern?
No, absolutely not. Take the United States fighting wars in Kosovo, in Iraq, in Afghanistan. They have certainly at a high level gone to extremes to protect innocent civilians.
You understand? You understand? 2 days before, he didn't know anything about any other battlefield. Now he knows that the U.S. has gone to extremes in order to protect innocent civilians. Wow. The point is, the person to know about what is the difference between the American army and the Israeli army is the chief of staff of the American army. The highest officer, he knows a bit better than Goldstone. Let's see what he said.
Israel went to extraordinary lengths to limit collateral damage and civilian casualties. In fact, about 3 months ago, we asked Benny if we could send a lessons learned team. One of the things we do better than anybody, I think, is learn. And we sent a team of senior officers and non-commissioned officers over to work with the IDF to get the lessons from that particular operation in Gaza, to include the measures they took to prevent civilian casualties. And
you understand? He is saying, I have to send the American officers in order to learn from the Israeli army how to protect innocent civilians. It's not enough. It's not enough because I conducted the research. I'm skipping and skipping because I have to finish. And I checked all the battlefields that Goldstone mentioned in order to understand how many combatants and how many non-combatants were killed in every battlefield. I went one by one. We don't have time to see it all. It's all in my book, by the way, Industry of Lies. I'm not going to take more time than what I already took. The outcome is very simple. Israel killed absolutely and proportionally less innocent civilians than any other army. I corresponded with Goldstone in that time. And I sent him one more email, and I told him, Dear Judge Goldstone, you were completely right when you said that the U.S. Army went to extremes in order to protect innocent civilians. But The meaning is that the Israeli army went to the extremes of the extremes of the extremes of the extremes of the extremes in order to protect innocent civilians. Here are the numbers. It was the first time that he did not answer me, as I expected. But he published an article, not because of me, because of a lot of other reasons. He retracted. And he said, if I had known then what I know now, the Goldstone report would have been a different report. It was too little and too late. The damage has been done. He summarized all what I wanted to tell you, because all what I wanted to tell you is, I want you to know, it has nothing to do with political views. Nothing to do with political views. It has to do with reality. It has to do with facts. It has to do with the fight against demonization. It has to do with fight against lies. And we cannot forget the Ten Commandments. We cannot forget the Ten Commandments. You should not give false testimony against your neighbor. That's what they do. False is destructive. Truth is constructive. Thank you so much for listening.